Well, hey, welcome to Journey Church Online. I'm Matt, and I just want to thank you for being with us today. I hope today will be a great experience for you. You know, at The Journey, we talk about, we're about relationships, not religion, and we don't want to do some religious things, and you can really have a religious experience anywhere. What we want to be about is about relationships, especially the relationship with God. We believe that, He wants to have a personal connection with each one of us. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is in James chapter 4. It says, if we draw near to God, that He will draw near to us. To me, that's just this picture of God with open arms of saying, I'm here for you. Follow me. I have life for you. No matter who you are, no matter what we've done, we can all experience that. You know, we're in this series called Bless, and we believe that God is the blesser, and He blesses us to be a blessing to others. And so I hope today that you will experience the blessing of God in your life so that you might share that with others. So let's just begin by turning our hearts and our focus towards Him. We've been praying a couple prayers throughout this series for God to do something bigger in and through our lives and for Him to show us how we can be a blessing in different places and with different people in our life. So let's just begin with that today. Ask God to meet with us. So will you pray with me? God, I pray as we are participating with Church Online right now that this might be a great experience for us to see who you really are, to connect with you. And we're asking you to do something bigger in our lives and through our lives and to show us how we can be a blessing to others. Show us the people and places where we can make an impact, where we can spread your kindness. And speak to us today. We just turn our hearts and our focus towards you. We pray in your name. Amen. Let's join the band as we continue to keep our focus turned to God.
There's no power like the power of Jesus. And I will praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall he can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that
There are so many people asking big questions, questions beyond like your job and your kids and your money and things like that. People are asking spiritual questions.
In all of our hearts seems to be this desire to find out what's really going on, what's really happening.
Exploring God to me is just like, it's a part of who we are. We're constantly in the search for meaning. We're constantly in the search for purpose. We're constantly searching for something that is outside of ourselves. And I even love that word explore because it indicates that it's a journey.
Personally, I mean, just where I'm at in my life, I think it's important to know why I'm here on the planet. And when I lay my head on the pillow at night, I kind of begin to ask those big questions of, all right, there's got to be more to this life than what I see and what I experience, because at the end of the day, my heart gets very discontent. And so that just leads me to asking the questions of, okay, there's got to be more, and if there is more, then what is that more?
Is this really real, you know? What if it's all in my imagination?
I would go on two kinds of journeys, I guess. I would go on an inward journey to ask, what do I really believe? And then I'd go on an outward journey to ask, God, if you're there, have you made yourself known in some way in the whole story of the world?
You know, I find that people so quickly and easily write it off, but they never actually take the time to search. And, you know, I used to think the same thing. I remember sitting there, you know, hearing this stuff, and I'd think, how do they know Jesus is the Son of God? I mean, who says? And, you know, how do you know it's not just myth? I mean, there have been lots of people who claim, you know, they're gods or the Son of God. I thought it was myth, but I just hadn't taken the time to really look.
This past week was a special week for us here at The Journey. It was Serve Week. This fall, we've been talking about being part of something bigger, and we want to do something bigger as a church. So we did a whole week of service projects, and there were a lot of great stories. You're going to be hearing some of those today in our Blessed series, as Paul shares with us in just a minute. But I just want to just say thanks to everyone who donated either things or their time, who served, who decided to take some steps to spread kindness. And I'm just so excited to see how this will continue to ripple the impact, not only in our lives and through our church, but in our community. So thank you so much for serving. You know, we want to do whatever we can to help you experience God in your life, to have that same experience of Him doing something bigger in your life and through your life. And so we always have some next steps that we offer. And if you go to the Next Step Center on our website, you'll see opportunities. There's a blog post for everything going on this month and all the details. There's a connect card if you need to request information or you're looking to get connected or you have prayer requests like that, you can use that connect card. There's a guest card if you kind of are new around here, but you're like, I want to experience that. I want to take steps. We'll encourage you to do that and help you as we can. You know, all those things are available right there. There's also a whole list of opportunities that we always offer some next steps. And one I want to highlight today is our beginnings class. It's starting in a couple weeks, and there'll be an online option, a virtual option. And so what we do with our beginnings class, it's for people who are exploring God, who maybe recently began a relationship with Him or are still considering that, and or you have questions, and it's a great place where you can ask questions and dialogue with other people who have the same questions. It's a place to begin and to explore God. So that's starting. If you go to our Next Step Center, you'll find the details on that blog post, or if you go to the Journey class section, and I encourage you just to register to that if that's going to be a great next step for you. There's also lots of other details on there. Again, you can use that Connect card if you need any additional information. And you'll see on there also links for giving on our donate page. And I just want to say thank you so much for giving. It allows us to do everything that's possible, whether it's online church or the projects in our community. So thank you so much as we partner together to spread kindness in our community and to share hope around the world. So thank you for your giving. Well, today we are going to be continuing our series called Bless. Paul's going to be sharing with us. So far, we've talked about how we want to begin with prayer. We want to listen to others. We want to invite others to eat with us so that we can listen and experience life together. And we're continuing the series today. And Paul's going to be sharing with us just a minute. And I hope that, again, this is a great experience today for you to have God speak to your heart to show how He can do something bigger in and through your life. So let's just continue our series today.
Paul, I'm one of the pastors here at The Journey, and we are in the third week of a series that we're calling Bless, and it's based off of a book by Dave and John Ferguson called Bless, 5 Everyday Ways to Love Your Neighbor and Change Your World. And I want to encourage you to think about picking up that book, wherever books are sold, wherever you get those, and follow along with us to take the challenges, answer the questions behind each chapter, and look to take a step forward and how you might be a blessing to others. And that's really the heartbeat of this book. It's not so much that we're blessed, although we are, but then how we are a blessing to others as well. Matter of fact, in the book, the Fergusons talk about how we are not to be a bucket that hoards and holds our blessing, but a river where the blessing flows in us and through us to others as well. In this series, we've been using an acronym, BLESS, B-L-E-S-S, and each letter corresponding with a specific thing that we were talking about each week. In the first week, we used the B to talk about that we need to begin with prayer. We begin with prayer. We are dependent on God. We need Him to show up in our lives and in the lives of others. And God is already at work in the lives of every single person that will come eyeball to eyeball with. Just as God has been at work in your life through the years, sometimes when you didn't even really recognize it or want to hear it, God is at work in the lives of others. But we want to sync up with what He's doing and bless people as He brings them to mind. And so we talk about begin with prayer. We need to lean in to our relationship with God. And then we want to plan and prepare and then pray. And we just challenge you to pray this simple prayer, the blessed prayer. Heavenly Father, show me today who you want me to bless. Heavenly Father, show me today who you want me to bless. And then as He brings somebody to mind, or as you run into somebody in the mall and it just kind of triggers with you, like, I think this is the person, look to bless them. Ask God for the courage to help you to do that. So take that challenge. Even if you haven't done it thus far, maybe this is the first message that you're listening to, I want to encourage you to take that challenge and say, Heavenly Father, show me today who you want me to bless. And just see what He might do. And We would love to hear your stories if you've had opportunities to bless people over this series. And we're hoping to share some of those at the end of the series. And you can use a QR code that you see for the form to just kind of quickly share your story about how you had an opportunity to bless somebody. Last week, we talked about the L and the E in bless, and they are both about relational connections. The L was for listen. The truth is, a lot of people, most people, aren't very good listeners or question askers, and yet listening is loving. And when we look in the life of Jesus, he listened well to people's stories. And as he listened to them, it helped him know exactly how to bless them. So not only was he able to bless them maybe physically by healing somebody, but also to see maybe the emotional wounds or the spiritual hurts that needed to be healed as well. When we listen to people, we'll have the opportunity to bless them, because the truth is, a lot of what people are saying goes unheard because we're not really listening. And so let's listen, because listening is loving. And then we talked about the E, eat or experience. And some people are like, yes, I'm all about eating with people. That's great. Listen, it's all about an experience with somebody. It's eating, it's inviting, it's entering into relationship so that we can listen, so that we can bless. So B, begin with prayer. L, listen. E, eat or experience. And today we're talking about the first S in bless, and that's serve. Serve. One of the ways that we can be most like Jesus, one of the ways that we can really bless others, is when we serve them. So in serving, we're following the model of Jesus, right? Like he's led the way in all of this. Matter of fact, the Fergusons, in their book, talk about an account that is found in the New Testament of the Bible with Jesus and his disciples in John 13. They go into a home to have this meal together. And as would be typical in those days, you would enter the home and there would be a wash basin there and towels, and there would be a servant to wash your feet. You were living in on dirt roads with sandals on your feet, agricultural community. And so you were stepping in dirt and dust and mud and cow poop and chicken poop and all of these different things. And you'd come into the house and your feet were dirty. You need to have them washed before you would maybe recline at the table or sit down to eat. But Jesus and his disciples, they go into this house and there's a wash basin, there's made towels, but there was no servant. And everybody just gets around the table to eat. And it's not like our, you know, dining room table or kitchen table, and you've got chairs and a table. They would actually recline at the table. And so their feet were spread out. Their feet were kind of all up in somebody's business, all up in somebody's face with their cow poop on it and dirt and dust. And Jesus sees that opportunity and gets up, takes off his kind of outer coat, and he puts the apron on, and he goes and he begins to wash the disciples' feet. They want to push back, like Jesus shouldn't be doing that, but he continues to wash their feet. And then we read this in John chapter 13, verse 12 through 15. It says this: when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and he returned to his place, and he said, "Do you understand what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that's what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." Now, the Fergusons talk about how Jesus laid down his crown, right? He was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Son of God. He laid down his crown and he picked up his apron. And they press us in the book to simply wrestle with the question, what do we need to lay down? Is it our pride? Is it time? Is it expectations? Is it convenience? What are the things that keep us from serving and from serving in humility? See, Jesus not only models serving, he models humility, right? Here he is, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and he's washing other people's feet. Jesus is the one who is hanging out with people that, you know, nobody else would. Jesus is the one who is willing to touch people nobody else would touch. Serving and humility, we see in the life of Jesus, and serving and humility go hand in hand. And Jesus calls us to both. In the book of Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 through 7, it gives us a picture of that kind of serving and of who Jesus was. It says this in Philippians 2, verse 3, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, consider others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness." Jesus lived a life where he put the interest of others above himself. He served those that most people would just pass by. He walked with a humility about him. And we're called to walk with that same kind of humility and serve like Jesus served. We bless other people when we serve them. In serving, we put on the apron, and it helps us to walk in humility. And the truth is, we need that, don't we? Like, we need a little bit of humility in a world that's all about ourselves, and it's so easy to be very self-focused. Our kids need that too, right? That's one of the things I love about our network teams. When we serve in the community, and most of those experiences are family-oriented, that you can serve alongside of your kids, and they can see you serving, but they can also see that they can serve as well. And it gives them a little bit bigger view that the world isn't all about them. The world isn't all about you or me. That we are willing to live with humility and put the interests of others above ourselves. Now, serving is sacrificing. I mean, that's for sure true, right? Like, it takes time and energy. It's not always easy. There's maybe effort involved. Sometimes there's money involved. There's a giving of myself. I might have to miss the game or not get to sleep in or spend some gas money, but it is worth it. It is worth it. Why? Because of the difference it makes in the life of the other person. We truly bless somebody who needs it, and because of what it does in us, and because of what it does in our relationship with God. In Hebrews 13, verse 16, it says this, "And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices," it's a sacrifice, "God is pleased." Now, that's a pretty cool verse, because here's the deal. When we serve others and share with others, even though it's a sacrifice, it puts a smile on God's face. When you put the interests of somebody else above your own and you serve them, you bless them, you put a smile on God's face. It pleases him. And that sacrifice, whatever that is for us, is never for nothing. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58, it says this, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." It's never in vain. It's never for nothing. And you often get just as much or more out of it than the person that you're serving. Matter of fact, we hear that all the time in our network projects. People say, "Man, we went to go bless these people or help these people, but I got way more out of it. I was so encouraged," or, "They were a blessing to me as well." I think about our missions teams that have went around the globe in different places, and think about our last team that I was on, which we went to Peru and hung out with our compassion-sponsored children and the staff and the families. And I mean, people gave up time and vacation and money to go and be a part of it. But to a person, they would say they were more blessed than the people we went to serve. Like, we experienced that ourselves, right? Listen, all of that is motivation for serving and blessing others, right? We follow the model of Jesus. It brings humility, which we need. We bless others and point them to Jesus. It pleases God and puts a smile on his face, and it does a whole bunch for us as well. But there's another interesting aspect to serving that Jesus talks about in a passage of the Bible that honestly is a little bit complicated We don't have time to go all into it as much as I'd like to today, and it may even cause some questions, but I think it's important. In this passage that we're going to look at for just a moment, Jesus declares that our serving actually shows that we're followers of Jesus. That by our serving, we actually show that we're a follower of Jesus. That serving is an authentication of your faith and of my faith. And I think about somebody trying to use counterfeit bills, right? Like you get the gas station attendant that's like kind of looking in the light and putting the yellow highlighter on it. But if like there was somebody that was really good with forgery, and then you're looking at a real bill and a fake one, and you need somebody to come in and kind of put them under the microscope, look at the finer details and be able to point out which one was fake and which one was real. And there's a sense in which we get in this passage that we're going to look at that Jesus looks at our faith under the microscope. And how we serve the least of these shows whether we're real or fake. Whether our faith is real or it's a forgery, by how we serve the least of these. So in this passage, Jesus is talking about a coming judgment. And people standing at the gates of heaven and being separated like sheep and goats. Like a shepherd would come in with sheep and goats all together, and you have to get the goats on one side and the sheep on the other side. And that's the picture that we get here. In Matthew chapter 25, it's the first book of the New Testament, verse 31. It says this, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. This is a picture of Jesus. He is the Son of Man. And the picture is of him coming back again, triumphant, to rule over his new kingdom, to usher in eternity and life with God forever. And the picture of the nations kind of all being gathered together for this judgment, and some being put on the right and some being put on the left. In Matthew 25, verse 34, it goes on, it says this, then the king will say, Jesus will say, to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Come enjoy everything that eternity has to offer, all of the beauty of heaven, the eternity that is in front of you. Come and enjoy it. It says, for I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes, you clothed me. I was sick, you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Jesus invites some into his kingdom. And the reason? Because of how they cared for him, he says. What? Like, certainly not all those people could have cared for him, right? And, like, when was Jesus hungry and thirsty? I mean, I'm sure there were some times, and some people maybe gave him some food, or sick, or in prison, naked. Like, what does this mean? And if it doesn't make sense to you, well, you're in good company, because it didn't make sense to the people in this story either, in this account. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 37, it goes on, and it says, then the righteous are going to answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger, invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? Now, if Jesus said, enter into eternity and all of life with me because of your faith, or because you've trusted me as your Savior, or even, although we don't believe this, but even because you've been pretty good, it at least would have made sense, but this doesn't seem to really make sense. We didn't even feed you and serve you that way. What do you mean? And in Matthew chapter 25, verse 40, he says this, the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Jesus says, how you cared for others and served and blessed, it's like you were doing it for me. When you care, when you serve, when you sponsor a child, when you bring a meal, when you help with rent, when you invite somebody over, it shows your faith and trust. It shows that your faith isn't a forgery. It's the real deal. the next verse shows the other side of the coin. Because that was just one group of people. There's a whole other group of people that are kind of waiting for their judgment. And those are the ones who have chosen not to enter into his kingdom and into all that that has in store because they didn't do anything to serve the overlooked or the dismissed. They respond the same way as the first group. What do you mean when you were naked or in prison or hungry or thirsty? Like, we never see you, you know, living kind of in that situation. And in Matthew chapter 25, verse 45, he says this. He will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me." He says, listen, heaven, eternity, okay, these people, yes, these people know because of what they did for the least of these. Now, this is not what, in theology, they talk about salvation by works. This idea that you can earn your way to heaven. This is not what this is. We've talked about this often at the Journey. There is no giant scale where you hope your good outweighs your bad, and if it does, then you'll go to heaven. There just is not that scenario because no matter how good you are, you will never be up to the standards of a perfect, holy God. You will always fall short. That what we believe, what we talk about often, is that it is by faith alone and by grace alone. Jesus went to a cross. He died for your sins and my sins. He took our place. It was like he stood before the judge and said, I know they're guilty. I know what they've done. I'm going to do the time for them. And we're set free. And so he takes our place. When we put our trust and faith in Jesus, our Savior, he's willing to do this swap where he takes our place. And instead, we can experience life and freedom with God. We can be right with God once again. And so when we read this passage, though, it sounds like, well, it's like what you do. But the way that they cared about the least of these wasn't the cause of their salvation. It was just the evidence of an authentic faith. It wasn't the cause of it. It wasn't like, because you did this, now you're in. But instead, it was the evidence. It showed that it wasn't a forgery, but it was real. It's the proof of their faith and trust in Jesus. And that genuine faith produces a love and a care for others. You know, the least of these are those the world sees as unimportant, dispensable, the overlooked, the dismissed. And this is the point of the passage, that when we're truly following after Jesus, that our heart out of that will flow out like him, like Jesus, will be a servant in humility, and will look to the least of these, to the interest of others. And this is not optional. And this is one of the driving forces of our network teams, right? It's why we partner with Muskegon Rescue Mission or Every Woman's Place or Hope Project or Love in Action or organizations where there's children in need. Because one of the ways that we bless others and we show Jesus to people is by serving the least of these, by serving those in need and in humility. We are blessed to be a blessing. And one of the ways that we're a blessing to others is when we serve. This last week at the Journey, we participated in our first ever Serve Week. Our network teams kind of wrapped that up on Saturday with service projects, but all week long we had different opportunities to serve our community, to love well, to care for those in need, and in humility to try to model like Jesus and be a blessing to those around us. Here's a few highlights.
Get money to buy hoodies and winter clothing for the rescue mission.
Yep. What do we have? What other guesses? Any others?
376.
415.
Jimmy is the closest at $419. Woo!
It's day two of Serve Week, and we are at The Journey, and we are making the Veterans Appreciation Cards for Veterans Day.
Hey Journey Church, it is night three of Serve Week, and we're helping out the rescue mission tonight. We're gonna be taking care of some supplies and some moving things for them to help them out. We also have a big donation from Monday night of all kinds of hoodies and winter gear to help out men and women and kids.
Things like that. But to get this stuff out of this basement is a huge help to me, and by helping me do that, then it helps, you know, all the directors and the people that are in direct contact with the guests. So we house about 50,000 people a year and feed about 100,000 people a year at the mission.
Journey Church, it's Adam here. Super excited. So all those cans, that $450 worth of cans, so over 4,000 cans, filled this car with hoodies and coats and boots and gloves and hats for men, women, children. Yeah, I emptied a couple stores, so.
And that is so cool, the way that we can serve our community, bless our community by serving people, by sacrificing a little bit to serve others. And I'm guessing if you participated in that, that you felt just as blessed as the people that you served. And I love that we can be a part of something so much bigger than ourselves. And when we do that together, the impact, like we've seen this week, can be so much bigger as well. I love the way that we live that out at The Journey. But this is also personal as well. Like, it's awesome that we can do that as a group, and that's huge and impactful. But it's also personal, too. If you want to bless your neighbor and change your world, if you want to be a person who is blessed to be a blessing, you're a river where that blessing flows in and through you, it will happen when you take off the crown. Those things that you kind of, maybe it's convenience or time or effort or whatever it might be, you put on the apron and you're willing to serve somebody else in humility. In humility, we serve others because of Jesus and for Jesus. And so as we wrap up today, I want to leave you with a couple of challenges. The first is a challenge that we've had all series long. Would you every day this week pray the Bless Prayer? Heavenly Father, show me today who you want me to bless. And then as he brings somebody to mind, as you see somebody at work or at school or at the store, wherever it might be, and he prompts that, you know, in you, or that person, you know, it's just very clear, like, I think this is the person that God's talking about to me today. Would you go and bless them? And would you bless them this week by serving them? Find some way to simply serve the other person. And kind of second part of the challenge this week. This week, would you also look to serve somebody that the world would see as the least of these? Somebody who's overlooked, dismissed, seen as dispensable. But let's serve the least of these this week as well. When we follow his model, we'll bring blessing to other people. We'll point to Jesus, and it will even show Jesus that our faith isn't fake. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, would you do a work in us that we would, in humility, serve others, that we would be a river of blessing to those around us, that we would put the interests of others in front of our own, that we would look to serve the least of these and anyone that comes to our mind this week. God, I pray that you would bring people to mind this week that we can bless. And God, that we would live in such a way that it would be evident that our faith is real, not a forgery. God, when we serve, we bless. When we serve, it will point people to you. And so would you help us to do that this week? In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thank you so much for sharing, Paul. You know, as we're talking about serving, Paul challenged us to look for the people who might be the least of these, maybe people that we wouldn't always notice, and to have open eyes and courage to share hope with them. And so I want to encourage you to keep praying that prayer that we've been praying for this Blessed series. God, show me the people and places that you want me to bless. Let's keep praying that. Let's look for opportunities to serve others as we go through this week. And we have something else coming up too. The first weekend of November, if you're local, we have the Yard Ambush. It's an annual event where we go and we help some people who are less fortunate by cleaning up their yards and taking care of them for fall. So if you're local, be looking for those opportunities. And I'm so glad you joined us today. I want to encourage you to keep taking those next steps to experience God doing something bigger in and through your life. And really encourage your kids to do that as well. And so if you've got kids right now, I encourage you to gather them up, do Sundays at Home. You can find all the resources on our parents page on the Journey Kids section of our website. So again, we want to keep building a foundation for them to experience God as well. Well, thanks again for being with us today. Next week, we're going to have another part of this series. So be looking for opportunities to serve others this week. Be back here next Sunday to be challenged how you can experience God in your life again. And until then, I encourage you just to keep following Jesus and spreading kindness. Share hope with others. And remember, we're better together. And we'll see you here next week, Journey. Have a great week.